Yeah, I think she's into you, so we'll do it next time, amen? Amen. Well, praise the Lord. I'm glad to see you guys. You guys blessed?
Yeah, we are.
Amen. Turn with me over to Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3. That was last Sunday with Brother Stephen Powell. He was here last Sunday. Last Sunday night was such a good message, man. I don't know if some of you might have missed. If you missed, I encourage you to watch it online on YouTube if you can, or get the CD. He taught last Sunday night. I guess you could call it a teaching, but he just really shared about his life and just going through that wilderness part of his life, and how he just had to be patient for the Lord, and how the Lord had called him as a 19-year-old kid, and he just spent a period of time just sitting before the Lord and going through jobs and just doing different things like that. And the Lord just kept talking to him. But he just really emphasized on being patient before the Lord and waiting on the Lord and being before Him and letting the Lord promote you, letting the Lord lead you into what He's called you to do. Amen? And it's a process sometimes, isn't it? But it's always a process, really, to be honest with you. But you know, I just encourage you to listen to that again if you can. If you hadn't heard it, was last Sunday night, it's on YouTube, or get the CD or something. But, man, it was really an excellent teaching. Amen. Tonight, I just want to talk about, I don't really fully know exactly what. I know the Lord's giving me a couple scriptures here, and we'll just see what He wants to do. But here in Colossians chapter 3, let's go ahead and start at verse 12 here. Colossians 3, verse 12. It says, therefore, as the elect of God. You the elect of God?
Yep.
There's like three people in here. That's awesome. You the elect of God. Amen. If you're born again, child of God, you give your life to Jesus, you're His elect.
Amen.
He's elected you. He's chosen you. He's called you by name, praise God. He wants to use you for His glory. Amen?
Amen.
So it says, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved.
Yes.
Don't ever call yourself, I'm not holy enough. God just said, you are holy enough.
Yes.
Well, what's holy? Well, there's all kinds of different opinions, all kinds of different, you know, you can answer that question all kinds, and I'm not going to say I know exactly fully 100% what it is, but in my eyes, in my mind, in my heart, when someone asks you what's holy, to me it's somebody that has presented their life before the Lord and given their life to Jesus. That's someone that's holy.
Amen.
Because they've recognized that they need a Savior and they need Jesus. And they know the only way that they can live righteous before Him is if they give their life to Him. Mm-hmm. Amen? Yeah. Holy isn't, you know, wearing certain clothes or talking a certain way or going to a certain thing or praying a certain way. That isn't holy. Holy is somebody that God calls. If you come before Him and give your life to Him, you're elected by Him, you're His elect, and you're holy and you're beloved by Him. That's what God says.
Amen.
See, the devil, the Bible says in Revelation chapter 12 that the devil is the accuser of the brethren.
Right.
That he comes in and he accuses the body of Christ. He accuses people that are in the body of Christ, the bride of Christ. He accuses us. He says, you're not holy. You're not righteous. You're not loved. You're this. You're that. You're that. Listen, how many of y'all believe the devil's a liar?
Yeah.
The devil is a liar. Amen? And he comes at every single person here with some kind of thought, some kind of issue, some kind of deal to get you over into fear, or some kind of deal to get you over into self, you know, I'm not worth anything, I'm worthless. He tries to accuse you of all this stuff. You don't love God enough because you said this, or you did this, or you went. Listen, folks, if that was the truth, none of us would qualify to loving God. Come on now.
Amen.
That's right.
I've done things in my past that I'm not proud of. That if I knew it wasn't for God's grace, I'd probably be dead by now. But because of His love and His mercy for me, He saved me. He healed me. He helped me. And you know what's so awesome about this? Is I'm 42 years old, and He's still working on me. Isn't that good? Praise God. still healing me, still helping me, still ripping things out of me by the roots that have hung on, or just ways of thinking, or just whatever. You've heard me talk about that kind of stuff lately, but it's true. We're a work in progress. Amen. But see, the devil wants to come in and accuse you and say, you are not beloved. See, you are not holy. You are not of God. You are not righteous. Listen, the Bible says that if you're in Christ Jesus, you are righteous. The Bible says that He is in you and you are in Him. The Bible says that Jesus Christ is seated above in heavenly places, that we are seated above in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Well, how is that? Because I'm here on earth, right here. I can hit myself. I can touch this podium here. I'm here on earth. How is that? Your spirit, your inner man, is linked with God because you've given your life to Him, so you are together in Him.
Amen.
See, we've got one thing that I really believe that every Christian needs to do at least once is study the in Christ revelations, the in Christ teachings. Amen. Who you are in Christ. So when you give your life to Christ, you need to really know who you are in Christ and who He is in you.
Amen.
That'll change your life.
Amen.
And the Bible says in Romans 8, there is there now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Amen. But see, the devil wants to condemn. He wants to bash. He wants to lie. He wants to accuse you. He wants to say this and say that. Folks, let me tell you something. The devil is a liar, and Jesus did it once and for all. He gave His life, shed His blood, so that you can be free once and for all. He went to hell, took the keys from the devil, crashed the gates, destroyed them, took death, hell, and the grave from him, and just set us free.
Amen.
So we are chosen by God.
Yes.
It's so wild, and this is something that I have a tough time wrapping my mind around sometimes because I don't fully understand it, but the scripture there, I believe it's in John, where it says that God, we didn't choose God. God chose us.
Amen.
Yeah. That's amazing.
Yeah,
really, Lord? Wow. You chose me. It's kind of like Jeremiah there in the chapter 1, Jeremiah. God calls him a prophet. He's a youth. He's young. He says, I want you to go out, Jeremiah. I want you to speak the words that I give you, the words that I put in your mouth. I want you to say to people. I want you to share. I want you to prophesy what I tell you to do. And Jeremiah, the first thing he says is, me? Are you sure, God? I'm just a youth. I'm young. But God said, don't worry about all that. I'll put the words in your mouth. Don't be afraid of their faces. Don't worry about them. You just do what I tell you, and I will provide to you what you need, the provision you need, what you need to say, the words you need to say, where you need to go, what you need to do. I'll give those to you. See, listen, the Holy Spirit knows everything.
Amen.
Yes,
He does.
He gets His orders from the Father God. He knows it. The Bible says He's our comforter. He's our counselor. He leads us into truth. He'll lead us into truth. You ever, thought you were right on a certain thing, and then about 10 years later, you find out, man, I was wrong the whole time on that. That's not even right. You ever been there before?
Yeah.
Me too. Concerning the Word, or concerning maybe your walk with Christ, me too. The Holy Spirit reveals things to us. So, the Holy Spirit knows everything. He knows what you need to say. He'll make up for your inadequacy.
Thank you.
As a human being.
Yes.
He has tons of times for me, believe me.
Amen.
I would have never thought in a million years like this morning that word of knowledge that I have about somebody losing a credit card and it was a Visa card. And Grandma Pat lifts her hand and says, my daughter just lost one yesterday and it was a Visa card, And the Lord had a word for her daughter, even though her daughter wasn't even here. See, the Holy Spirit knows.
Amen.
He knows what to say, when to say, how to say, and how to get it to you when He needs to get it to you. That's how awesome the Holy Spirit is.
Amen.
He can wake you up in the middle of the night and give you a dream. He can wake you up in the middle of the night and give you a word. He can wake you up in the middle of the night and speak something to you that will change your life forever. Or even speak something to you to give to somebody else that will change their life forever.
Amen. Yep.
I guarantee He's used a lot of you to do that already, and He's going to continue to do it if you just stay open to Him.
Amen.
But see, the devil wants to accuse us, to keep us. It's basically what he's trying to do is intimidate you.
Right. Yeah.
To keep you out of the will of God, to keep you from pursuing God.
Yeah.
It's the truth. The devil bad, God good.
That's right. Amen.
black and white, evil and good, truth and a liar, heaven good, hell bad.
Amen.
It's the truth.
Yes, sir. That's right.
He hates us. He loves us.
Amen.
Yep.
Exactly.
So he wants to intimidate the devil, tries to intimidate you. You know, the Bible says in Isaiah that he is the blacksmith, that he will conjure up and he will have demons and he will have his angels come after you, come against you, to attack you, to get you over into doubt and unbelief, to get you, because listen, once you're born again, you're born again. The only chance he has now, the only thing he can try to do now is to get you over into doubting who you are in God or what God's, what Jesus has done for you. That's all he's got.
Amen.
Or to get you over into fear about something and have you focus on the lie instead of on the truth, right? So if you're a born-again child of God, that's his only shot. If you aren't a born-again child of God, you're already in his hands. He is your father. Now, I hope that ain't for nobody in here. I hope everybody in here is born again. If you're not, we'll talk after church, or you talk to someone you came with to get born again. But that's for someone on the internet. If you are not a born-again child of God, your father is the devil. That's who you serve.
That's right.
I don't care how good of a person you got to pick. Choose one or another. And it's awesome how God is. He gives us free will to choose who we want to serve.
Right.
Do we want to serve the devil? Do we want to serve God? Do we want to serve ourselves? Well, come on now. Hallelujah.
Yes, indeed, brother.
It's true.
Yep.
So, I don't know why I got off into all that, but that must be for at least one person. Amen.
Yep.
If it is, just be blessed by that, because Jesus loves you.
Yeah.
He loves you. God breathed out of his mouth you into creation.
Amen.
Because he loves you and he's destined you and ordained you to do his work. Amen?
Thank you.
So it says, therefore, verse 12, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, and long-suffering, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against one another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do.
Uh-oh. Yes, that's right.
Now, one of the accesses, one of the roads that the devil has into your life is by you not walking in love.
Right.
By you living in some kind of unforgiveness, bitterness, hatred towards somebody, something like that, that creates an access, a door open in your life for the enemy to come in. And only the Lord knows what's going to happen with that.
Yeah.
But it isn't going to be good. See, I had to learn this in my life. In 2007, 2008, I went through a crash course, man, while I was going through leukemia. I went through a crash course with God on how to love people and how to release people and forgive them and let go of stuff that people has done to me or whatever. I mean, I'll tell you, I'll just be honest. I mean, there was a time in my life where I was holding something against somebody here in town that did my dad wrong in 1985. When I was a 9-year-old kid. 10-year-old kid.
Yeah. It happened. Yeah.
Hated this guy, man.
Right.
Yeah.
I'd see him around town as a teenager, and I'd flip him off, try to call him out as a teenager. I saw him driving around or something like that. I just developed a hatred towards this guy. And I'll tell you, I'm a transparent kind of guy. It's fine. I've forgiven the man, and the man's not even here anymore. He's gone on already. But way too young, too. But I had to go through a crash course in 2008 and get my love walk straightened out, man.
Yeah.
I was so scooped up in my head concerning holding things against people and not liking people and getting irritated with people and just saying, forget it. Forget them. Bad attitude. Not loving at all. That wasn't like that with everybody, but you know what? It doesn't have to be everybody. It can be just one person that can really mess you up. And so through 2008, man, I had to go through this course of learning how. You know, you ever realize you go through something tough in your life, and you kind of wake up and smell the coffee, you know?
Yeah.
That's a good thing.
Yes.
Smell a lot of coffee. Yeah. Me too, man. But going through this process, I'm like, okay, Lord, I obviously have an issue in this. And I obviously can see, because I've been taught this way, and I know this is the truth, Lord, that this is an inroad to letting the devil into my life to hurt me, mm-hmm. to cause problems,
yeah.
not walking in love.
Yeah.
And so I had to meditate on these scriptures right here reading. And there's several more scriptures that I had to just meditate on. And the Bible says that God has shed abroad His love upon us. He's already given us a piece of His love. He's already given us His love. But it's up to us to develop that love. And one way you develop that love is you keep your heart right towards others and you love them. And when you decide, because we all do this, we say something out of our mouth towards somebody, we get irritated. You know, just watching the news the past couple days, I've had to repent probably 30 times. From some of the stuff I've seen on TV. And just the anger that rises up in you when you see this stuff. But then you got to step back and realize that if people only knew what they were doing,
Right. Yeah. They
wouldn't do this. Because
right.
I was in the same boat. If I only knew what I was doing and not being deceived by the devil with that, I would have stopped it a long time ago.
Yeah.
You all understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
Okay. So we've got to learn that we've got to walk in humility. With one another. We've got to learn that we've got to walk in love with one another. There's going to be people that don't agree with what you agree with, what you believe. There's going to be. But you know what? You still, listen, some folks, the only hope they have is you loving them. Love casts out fear, the Bible says. Love covers a multitude of sin, the Bible says. That's huge. That's big, big. And that there's this person right now in my life that I'm just loving on when I see him. I treat him with respect. I treat him right. I love on him. And I know that God's opening the door for me right now to eventually probably lead them right on into to Jesus Christ. I know it's coming soon.
Amen.
I'm watching the Lord set this thing up with this person.
Amen.
And so I'm just going step by step with God and I'm just loving on him. See, people really don't care what you think. Listen. People want to know that you really care about it.
Right. That's
yeah.
Right. Exactly.
See, that's why when I coach sports with young kids, with teenagers and things like that, I never have problems with them. I really don't. I'm just being totally honest with you. And the reason why is because I've learned, first of all, you adapt to the kid. Each kid's different. You know that you get to know their personalities and how to treat them and handle them. Some kids you can just really disciplined. Some kids you just got to be a little softer on, you know what I mean? But I've learned that by me showing them respect, I don't even have to demand respect from them. They just give it back.
Yes, exactly.
If you love them and you treat them right, they'll love you and treat you right. Well, Pastor Mike, yeah, but I love this certain person and they cuss me out, they hate me, they talk about me.
Keep loving.
Keep loving.
Oh my God, love never fails.
Love never fails. They might not want to be around you for the next 10 years. They might even move away. But love never fails. The love that you plant in their heart as you love them, as you encourage them, as you bless them. And you know what the biggest thing you can do is you do it behind closed doors when nobody's around. Lord, I bless this person.
Yep.
I speak love over them, God. I thank you that confusion leaves their mind and they see who you really are, Jesus. They see who you really are, Father. I thank you for that. And Lord, if it isn't me, bring someone into their life, Lord, that they can love on them like I do, Lord, and bless them, Lord, so they see Jesus. Amen?
Yes.
But we're in a day now, we're living in a time now where darkness and light are so you can see it. You can see light and you can see darkness. And Jesus told us to go into all the world and to preach the gospel. And the way that we do that is by loving people.
Yeah.
Love will bring them in, guys. Love.
Yes. Amen.
Love will do it. Because I'll tell you, a lot of things we see that we just can't believe people would do that. They're influenced by a demonic spirit.
Right.
And they're deceived. And I'm having to learn me personally right now, instead of being angry and saying stuff about that or about them, I am to bless them.
Right.
Amen.
And pray that God will send somebody into their life to minister love to them.
Yeah.
It's like Dad said this morning, God will not work where there's no love. Why? Because God is love. The Bible says that where strife, contention, bitterness, envy, all that stuff, every evil work is involved in that. God's not evil. So, I didn't know I was going to preach about love tonight, but love's the key. Forgiving is the key.
Amen.
First of all, you'll know that you're right before the Lord because your heart's clean before Him. You know, I like going to the Lord like David did and said, Lord, I look upon my heart. Look upon my heart, Lord. If there's anything in me that is not of you, Lord, take it. I judge myself. I judge my heart, Lord. See, God is... Here's a prophetic word right here. Now listen to this. I can tell it just shifted right now already into that. God is setting you up, guys.
Yes, He is.
He's setting people up in your life. There's going to be people that He's going to bring to you. From now on, until you either leave this earth before Jesus comes back or until Jesus comes back, He's setting up divine appointments for us.
Amen.
As a ministry, but also as individuals. As your walk with Christ, your own personal walk with Christ. He's setting divine appointments up, guys, for us.
I believe.
And people, whether you know it or not, people right now are watching you.
Yes.
Are watching you. They're watching us. To see, are they really serious about this loving thing? Are they really serious about this Jesus thing? Did Jesus really change their life? And how they're going to know it is how you treat them. How they're going to know it is how you love them. How they're going to know it is how you treat others and you love others. How they're going to know it is just they're going to see the love of God on you when you walk in it. That's the most powerful thing on the face of the earth is the love of God. The love of the Lord. You know, this morning when Sister Dolores came up for prayer this morning, you know, I was getting ready to pray for her. Right when I got over to pray for her, sometimes this happens. It doesn't happen all the time, but it happened this morning. And I literally felt the compassion of Jesus just come on.
Yes, yes.
For her. See, because Jesus is the healer, not me. He's the healer. We're just vessels that He uses. He told us He wants to use us. He wants us to lay hands on the sick until they're recovered.
Yes, amen.
And so, just by stepping out and loving her, I felt the compassion of Jesus just come on me. And I felt Jesus just touch her, man. I don't know how else to explain it. It's a supernatural thing. You know? And so, that love, stay open to it. Stay open to that love. And I know that I feel like I'm preaching. Listen, it's funny because I know sometimes God will give me certain things to preach, and in my mind I'm going, God, these people know that already. I have a bunch of people in here I know that are already walking in love, that love people. I know it. But you want me to talk about it more? You should put yourself in my shoes sometimes, standing up here while I'm up here ministering this. I'm looking at everybody in here, and I don't know everybody, but I know 99% of the people in this place. And I know they love people, and I know they love the Lord. So it's like, why you got me preaching on this, God? We need to hear it. So do I. Faith comes by hearing and hearing and hearing the word of God.
Amen.
This will stir your love walk up tonight. Hallelujah. That's what the word does, amen. So it says, verse 14, but above all these things, the two verses we just read there, but above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection.
Wow.
And let the peace of God rule in your hearts,
amen.
To whom also you are called in one body, and be thankful. Now I want you to see the connection here. It says in verse 14, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. And then it says in verse 15, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts. There's something about that connection there, that love and that peace.
Yes.
That love and that peace. You ever notice when you truly are loving on somebody and you're talking to them about the Lord, or you're just loving on them because you see they need that love, and you're just being nice to them and you're trying to encourage them, and you feel that love come, what does it bring? It brings peace with it.
Yeah, amen.
Right.
Amen.
It brings peace. It's so good. Think about it. I mean, you can even think about your life right now, the times that you've ministered to somebody or loved on somebody, and you just think about the peace that it brings into that situation, to that person's life, and even brings into your life.
Amen.
To minister to you the peace of God. That's something that a lot of us, because of the way society is, I'm having to train myself. And I got an awesome teacher, my dad, he's constantly talking to me about this, how he did it. But to slow down and rest in the Lord. To slow down. You know, of course, work and be responsible, take care of your tasks, do what you need to do. But you've got to find time to slow down in your mind.
Yes.
And in your body. Think about it. When you're all wore out, do you have peace? No. It's like, oh my gosh, man.
Yeah.
But that love, you start loving on the Lord and the peace comes, like right now.
Amen.
And there's just a peace in here right now. This is a refreshing peace. You don't even, I mean, I wish we had a dime for every time someone over the last 33 years has said, when I walked into that building, when I was in that service, I've never felt peace like I felt when I was in there.
Yeah.
That happens to me every time. There's just a peace here, amen? It's a good thing, but it's in us. We take it with us. The same peace I experience here with my brothers and my sisters in Christ is the same peace I experience when I'm at home.
Yeah.
God is the God of peace.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen?
So love and peace go together. It says in verse 16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching, and admonishing one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing with grace or with favor in your hearts to the Lord. And whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. That's the scripture my son has on the back of his letterman's jacket. That verse 17 there. Everything you do unto the Lord, do it unto Him. Everything you do, do it unto the Lord. See, that verse, sing unto the Lord. Sing, when you get together like we are tonight, you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, making melody in your heart to the Lord.
Amen.
We get in here and we have praise and worship, the peace of God comes in.
Yes.
It sets a tone for the rest of the service. So the Lord, when there's peace, listen, when there's peace, healing happens.
Yes.
When there's peace, refreshing happens in your life. When there's peace, devils leave.
Yes.
They can't stand it.
Amen.
I think the hippies had it kind of right to some point. Peace and love,
baby.
Right. I'm too young for that stuff.
Yeah, been there, done that.
Been there, done that. Some of it was good, some of it was bad, right? But peace, man. Let peace rule and reign in our hearts.
Yes.
I found out in my life, honestly, when I'm at peace, it's a lot easier to love. I've learned in my life, that, and I'm just being honest, because we all have been there, but when you get agitated, and you're agitated about something, it's probably a good time for you to be alone and go somewhere and talk to God.
Yeah.
And that's one thing I'm really working on, man. Believe me, I'm working on it. You can ask my wife. Well, don't ask her, but you can if you want. But I'm really working on that agitation thing, man. But see, that comes from somewhere. And I believe it comes from fear. You get agitated because of fear.
That's true. Yes.
You begin to worry about stuff. You begin to fear stuff.
Yeah.
And you start to get on edge and you get agitated.
Yes.
But see, I'm learning how to recognize that and not run with it
for
3 days.
Amen.
I'm learning how to wait. You can ask my family. They'll hear me talking to myself. No, you're not doing that. Shut up, Mike. Shut up.
Yeah.
I have the mind of Christ.
Yes.
Devil, shut up, leave my mind alone, go. I have the mind of Christ.
Amen.
I live in peace. All is well. Amen. The Lord's got me from the beginning of being born in my mother's womb all the way to my gray-haired days, the Bible says. Yes. He's carried me.
Yes.
If something is broke, He fixes it.
Amen.
If I need, He provides.
Amen.
Because I follow Him. I either really trust Him or I don't. There's no 50-50.
Amen.
Right? That's just the nitty-gritty of it, man. That's what it comes down to.
Yes.
Really does.
Yes.
So, living in peace, living in love, it produces nothing but God.
Right.
That's what we want. And that's not nothing, but it's God. We want to produce God. We want to produce the love of God for people. I want people to know that I love them. And the reason why I love them is because God lives on the inside of me.
Amen.
And what He's done for me, He can do for you, praise God.
Amen.
You know, I have this neighbor across the street. It's a guy I grew up with. We went to school together. He's a year younger than me. And I just moved into this new house right after Christmas. And he's my neighbor across the street. And I've seen him over the years in school. We played slow pitch softball together for a good while out there and all this kind of stuff. So I ran into him and I've seen him. I haven't hung out with him or nothing. I've just, you know, been around him a little bit. And from day one, I'm watching God piece this thing together of me ministering to him.
Amen.
And you know what's wild is, like, I don't even look to minister to him. It just happens. It's like 4 times already since I've lived in this house. You know, I'll see him or something outside. I'm leaving or something. He's coming out or whatever. And it's like, hey, what's up? Hey, and we just start talking. And it just goes right over into yesterday. It's like I had a mini church service yesterday for about 20, 25 minutes in the road in front of my house talking to this man about the love of God. And how love will change your life. And I ain't going to get into all into it. But it's like, and he's just blown away. He's Catholic. And it's cool because they know Jesus. They know the story of the cross. They believe it. Which makes it easier to minister to people because they love Jesus already. He's got him on his neck, you know? So he loves him. And so it's just cool seeing. And yesterday when he was walking away, he said, we need to have more talks like this, man. I said, anytime, man. Because if I'm ever dealing with something, I'll just come talk to you. I said, dude, you can come talk to me anytime, man. That's totally awesome. And I said, you know what else? And he goes, what? And I said this. I said, if you ever have pain, you're sick, or any of your family, come over. I'll pray for them, and Jesus will heal them.
Amen.
I said that before I was even thinking about it. He goes, okay, I will. And I was like, all right, you know. Hot dog, man. But see? That love, and I like sharing examples and stories about that, but I've watched love heal people, man.
Sure.
I remember one time I had a situation, and it was several years back, and it was right before a church service on a Sunday morning. And this person just got really angry with me and just chewed me out before church. I know that some of you are like, oh, I wonder who it is. Don't worry. This person left a long time ago. So don't even try to think about who it is.
Oh, boy.
And I was getting ready to preach. Mom and Dad were gone. They were out of town or something, ministering somewhere, and I was here. And this happened about a half hour before service started. And I remember sitting in the office going, and I sat there for about 15 minutes just battling in my mind. I want to throw this person out right now. Like, I mean, you know how you see in those movies, you see an angel and you see the devil on each shoulder, you know? It was like one of those situations, you know? And I'm going, ah, then I'm going, okay, I got to forgive him. Then I'm going, ah, then I'm going, okay, I need to walk in love, you know? It's like this tug of war. And so finally I said, no. I said, devil, I see what you're trying to do before church.
Yep.
See what you're trying to do? You're trying to set me up, trying to ruin stuff. No. Shut up. I forgive this person, Lord. I ask you just to help this person, Lord.
Yeah.
Maybe they were right or they're legit about what they're doing or whatever, but Lord, that doesn't even matter, Lord. I will not let hatred or unforgiveness get in my heart. And I remember saying, Lord, I forgive them, Lord.
Amen.
I forgive them and I choose to love them.
Amen.
Sometimes you got to say it, Lord.
Yeah.
But when you say it and then you say it again and you say it again and you say it again, you get stronger and stronger and stronger. Your mind shuts up and your heart's convinced.
Yeah.
You know, and you mean it.
Yeah.
So I did that. And I'm going to tell you, I came out for praise and worship, saw the person, and your mind wants to shift over back into that carnality deal again.
Yeah.
Your mind. But you got to tell your mind to shut up, and you got to look in here.
Yeah.
So I just looked in here, and I said, no, I've already chose to forgive that person. It's not a feeling. I've forgiven them.
Yeah.
So I forgave them. Service went on. That service was over. I was back in the office getting my stuff. I heard the door knock, and I opened up, and it was this person. And this person came in, and she said, I shouldn't have did what I did earlier this morning. I'm really sorry. Please forgive me. And I said, I already have. But see, I share that story because a lot of times when you choose to do the right thing the way God has taught us to do it, to walk in love, it will change someone else and help them.
Amen.
When I came into the service that day, I had to deal with that person before I ministered and talked to them about something, and I did it in love. And it was like I acted as though if that didn't even happen.
Amen.
And I think it helped that person.
Amen.
And it helped her in some issues and some stuff.
Yes.
So see, even if we choose to do what God has told us to do concerning love, there will be some folks that won't like you, and there will be some folks that will like you.
Mm-hmm.
But that isn't our issue.
Amen.
That isn't our problem.
Amen.
We love them no matter what.
Yeah.
And I know it's hard for some people, and even me sometimes, like, man, Lord, people that have done the most heinous things, how can we love them, Lord, just because of that? And He says, I love them. The Lord loves them, but they choose to be that way.
Yes.
See, this isn't something that you just overnight do. It's something that you develop.
Amen.
And you know what? I'll be honest with you guys. This love thing can be developed quickly on a daily basis. And I'll tell you why. Because there's always someone that you can get offended by.
Yes.
There's always going to be someone that's going to say something to you. There's always going to be someone that's going to say something behind your back. There's always someone that's going to do something while you're driving down the street. There's always something you're going to see on the news. There's always a test every day.
Amen.
I'm not saying tonight that we're going to be perfect in this. But what I am saying tonight is we can develop a stronger love walk for people than we have right now.
Yeah.
None of us are pros. We're all growing in this.
Yes, we are.
But man, it does get easier, though, I'm telling you. When you choose to get that shift over in your mind. Wait, nope. Lord, I bless them. I love them. And you start asking. Here's what I started to do. I started to ask, Lord, let me see people through your eyes.
Yes, amen.
Yes, amen.
That was a big thing for me. That was a big difference for me. That was a big thing. Lord, let me see people through your eyes.
Amen.
And Lord, if they're hurting, Lord, let me help them if I can. Yes. Lord, open the door for that, Lord. I would love to help them, Lord. The Bible says that Jesus saw the people scattered. And Jesus said he had compassion. I had compassion on them, and they were healed. They were helped. But see, Rob Radosky, some of you guys know who he is. He's been here a couple times and preached. He lives in Las Vegas. And I hear him tell stories about going out on the strip in Las Vegas to minister to people. And he said, Mike, I'll tell you right now, I don't go up to him. And I don't shove Jesus down their throat. I don't preach the gospel even to him. You know what I do? And I guess this is the gospel. He says, I go up, I make friends, and I love on them. And I talk with them for a little while. And by me just loving on them and showing that I'm actually concerned about them or that I care about what's going on in their life, he says 90% of the time people will open up and I will be able to plant the seed into the life of the gospel of Jesus.
Amen.
I just love them. I treat them right. He said that there's a thing there in Las Vegas that they have the lesbian, gay, all the LGBT or whatever it is, deal they have it there every year. And he says, me and a group of people go out. We don't preach these people. We go out and we love on them. We love them. We ask them, is there anything in your life, your family that I can pray for you about? You know, see, in our minds we think, well, if we didn't get them saved, then that was worthless. No! You planted a seed of love into their heart.
Yeah.
You released Jesus into them because the anointing is real. It's real. The power of God is real. And so we've got to look at it that way, that when we're loving on somebody, they might not get saved that day, but they might come back to you in 2 years. Because I've watched that happen too, when they come back around. Or all of a sudden you get a phone call or a text or something. And we talk, man. I need help. So see, God knows. And when I said earlier about divine appointments this year, guys, I really believe that God is setting people in your life. He's setting things up ahead of time right now for you.
Yes.
To bring people into the love and the power and the gospel of Jesus.
Yes.
I believe that.
Amen.
I speak that prophetically tonight. I really believe that that's true. So stay open to divine appointments. Stay open to His love. Now look here at, I'm going to wrap it up right now, but look over here in Ephesians. Pretty similar scriptures here, but just a little bit of a twist here. Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5. Verse 1 says this. Therefore, be imitators of God as dear children, and walk in love as Christ also has loved us and given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma. Be imitators of God. Did you know that God's only motive is love? God's only motive is love. Everything God does is because he loves you. Everything he does is because he loves. Even when he pulls that blanket off of darkness and exposes it, is because he loves us and those people. How he talks to you and how he shows you things about your life, and maybe he will correct you. He's corrected me a bunch of times. When he corrects you out of love because he loves you and he sees. It's like my children, you know? When I correct them because I love them and I'm trying to teach them that they can't allow this in their life because it'll hurt them. It's the same scenario with God. When he corrects us, it's because he loves us. Amen? His only motive is love. And then it says here, look over here in verse 15. It says, see then that you walk circumspectly. That word circumspectly there means seeing everything, keeping your eyes open, being aware of what's going on around you in the Spirit. By your fellowship with Father God. It says, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Now, how do we do that? We pray and we find out what the will of the Lord is for our lives. That's how we do it. Amen? We ask the Lord. And then it says, and do not be drunk with wine in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Singing and coming before the Lord, it brings the peace of God. It brings the knowledge of God. It brings revelation of God. I found out in my life, and I know many of you have too, probably, you know this already, but by you singing before the Lord, worshiping Him, telling Him you love Him, and all that good stuff, it opens up the spiritual realm to you to where you can commune with your Father. And there's times where I've started out doing that, just worshiping the Lord, and He'll bring correction to me. Or He'll warn me about something. Or He'll give me revelation on a certain thing in my life that I wasn't understanding, and he'll bring the light to that thing in my life, and which will keep me from getting into harm.
Yes. Amen.
Or he'll talk to me about something I need to change in my life. Or he'll talk to me about how much he loves me.
Yes.
And how much he has for me. And he'll talk to me and show me, you know, this is what I got for you. Keep following me, and you're going to be able to help thousands and thousands of people because you love me. And see, guys, that's it right there. Everybody in here, you love the Lord and you follow him. He'll use you. And you know what Jesus said? Forget the 99, even if it's just one. I'll go back to him and help him. Even if it's just one. Even if you only, which you're not, but even if you only help one person this lifetime come to Jesus, that's the best thing ever.
Amen.
And it's not going to only be one. Believe me, there's a lot of people in here. And you don't even, I believe that all of us, we've helped people we don't even know we've helped over the years. I believe it. We won't know until we get to heaven and they come up and say, you talked to me on July 27, 1989.
Yeah.
And it changed my life. I never saw you again. I believe that stuff, guys.
Yeah.
There's people that I've ran into that I don't even know that have said certain things to me over the years. Not all the time, but it's been happened a couple times. And it's changed my life forever, and I've never seen them again. But that word they said stuck me right in my spirit, and it's been there forever. It's been there since. I had a lady prophesy to me in 8th grade, man. She was another Christian here in town. I knew her. I knew her son. I knew she went to another church here in town. And I was just being goofy. I was out at the softball field because I wanted to hang out with the girls and watch the girls play, you know? That's why I was there, me and my buddies. And she came up to me and she said, can I talk to you, Mike? I'm like, sure. So I go over there and she says, you know, the Lord's been talking to me about you. I'm like, oh, great. What now? You know? Well, I'm not here, man. I'm not here to check out the girls, you know what I mean? I mean, that's why I'm out here. I'm not here to be at church, you know? And she said, and I stood there and listened to her. I respected her. And she said, I see you like this lump of coal right now. But God's going to rub that off and you're going to turn into a diamond. He's got good things for your future, for your mind. He's going to use you. I'll never forget that. I was in 8th grade, a long time ago, man. And I'll never forget that. And all these years, that's been there. And at the time, I rebelled against it. I'm like, nah, I know what you're saying. I'm not pastoring. In my mind, that's what I was thinking. I did not want to be a pastor. Didn't want anything to do with it. People would always say, you're going to be just like your dad, Mike. I'd be like, nope. I mean, I love my dad, and sure, I love my dad's characteristics, and he's an awesome man, but no, I'm not going to be a pastor like my dad, dude. No way. Forget it. Never say never, right?
Yeah.
I guess that's true. But that lady, that stuck with me all those years. That's happened to you guys. You've been able to do that into other lives. Believe me. There's some of your family members and some of your friends you haven't heard from a long time. They're going to end up calling you. And saying, pray for me, I need Jesus.
Yes, amen.
Help me, I need help.
Amen.
It's going to happen. It's already happening, really.
Yes.
But why will all that happen? Because of love. We walk in love. I know we got a lot of lovers in here, man, I know it. We got a lot of people that love God. We got a lot. Everybody in here I know loves God. He wouldn't be here tonight. But it's my prayer that I grow, me personally, and I hope it's your prayer that you grow, that you want to grow personally with the love of God.
Yes, amen.
Help us, Lord, from not complaining.
Amen. Amen.
Help all of us.
Yes.
We don't want to complain.
Amen.
We just want to praise, man.
Yes.
Amen. Well, praise the Lord. I thought I'd finish, so I don't know what else to do, but you're going to have love assignments this week, guys.
Amen.
Okay.
By the time you get home, you might have a love assignment.
Right.
It's a good thing. It's a good thing. Amen. Guys, I want to say that I love you guys. And I'm thankful for you guys, and I'm thankful for all your prayers for my family, and it's kind of a thing that we all do for each other. We pray for each other. And love conquers all. And I say tonight, I bless you guys in Jesus' name. Every single person that's here, I bless you in the name of Jesus. And I pray the peace of God. I pray the joy of the Lord. I pray that every need is met in the name of Jesus over everyone's life in this place. And I pray that God will send you people this week that they can pick off your tree the fruit that you have of love, the fruit that you have of peace in Jesus. That they'll pick off that tree from this week. I pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord, just give us divine appointments this week. Bring someone across our path, Lord, that we can simply just love on and help. Whatever way it is, if it's buy them a lunch, if it's buy them a coffee, God, if it's just give them an encouraging word, tell them they're going to be all right, that Jesus loves them, and he's going to help their family. Whatever it is, Lord, I ask you just to use our mouth to speak love and health and healing into someone's life this week, Lord. And Lord, we say we are available to do that, Lord. We open up our hearts. We say we will be your vessel of love for others, Lord. So I just speak blessing over every life in this place tonight, Lord. Thank you for giving them a blessed week. And Lord, we thank you for these meetings coming up starting Friday through Sunday with Todd Bentley, Lord. I thank you, Father, that him and his team have safe travels out here from North Carolina, Lord. And I thank you, Father God, that people come that need healing in their bodies, God. That the harvest will come in, Lord. That people will be saved, set free, and healed, Lord, this weekend, Father. And Lord, our hearts are open to pray for these meetings this week, God. And Lord, I ask you that if you want us to invite someone, Lord, put them on our heart, Lord, and we will reach out to them, Father. And we give you the honor and the praise for everything that's said and done in this place tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, God bless you guys. You just missed. Praise God. Love you guys. Have a blessed week. And be safe out there, man, because the roads are wet.